Everybody doing good this morning? Good. Well, my name's John. I feel like there's some folks that I see around here that I haven't seen before. So if I'm the new one and not you, then welcome to me, and otherwise welcome to you. Thanks for being here today. So I think I've probably told you guys once or twice, but I have lived my whole life in church life. Both of my grandfathers were pastors. My dad is a pastor. And until I was probably 25 years old, I could count on both hands the number of Sunday services I had missed. Just that was kind of the deal. Always go to church no matter what. Go on vacation. We'll find a church to go to while we're on vacation. Anytime anything was going on, we're going to be at church no matter what else. So that was kind of my whole life growing up. And there's a lot of really good in that. And there are also some things that I look and maybe some downsides to that. One of the downsides I found was that the Bible has become very familiar to me. So I find myself, when I'm reading scripture, I kind of go into autopilot and go, oh yeah, I remember this passage. I've heard that before. I've been taught that passage. So I kind of tend to, at times, just kind of gloss through stuff. And that's a really bad way to approach God's word, right? So I found one of the solutions to that problem in my own life is to use different translations of the Bible. So I grew up, my dad always taught out of the New American Standard Bible, so that's what I grew up on. And I mean, there was a time in my life, I've hit my head since then, but there was a time in my life when I could quote the entire chapter of Romans 8, and another time when I could quote all of Ephesians. So those passages that were just kind of really familiar, when I would read them on my own, I would just kind of skip through them and not really slow down and pay attention because it was just familiar. So I've switched over, and I now study and teach out of the English Standard Version, which is a really well-translated version of God's Word, but it's enough different from what I grew up with that it makes me stop and read. I've also, since we had kids, I've discovered a book that is called the Jesus Storybook Bible. Have you guys ever heard of that? Anyone? Yes? It's fantastic. It's a lady wrote, her name is Sally Lloyd-Jones, and basically her goal was to run from Genesis through Revelation and point out all along the way how Jesus and the gospel is woven all the way through Scripture. And she writes that obviously it's kind of geared towards children, kind of the idea is that you can just read it as a daily or nightly devotional with your kids. But it's the way she writes and the way she approaches God's word is really beautiful. And I want to share one of the passages that she has written, and it's based out of Mark chapter 4. So I'm going to read this passage, and then we'll go back and read the scripture and see how it kind of lines up. Good deal? So some of you guys, this story may be familiar to you, but even if it is, maybe this retelling of it will help. And the best part is, it comes with pictures, so you guys won't be bored. Here it comes. This is from the Jesus Storybook Bible. It says this: the sun was going down. The air was warm and still. Let's go across to the lake, Jesus said to his friends. Jesus had been helping people all day, and he was tired. So they left the crowds at the shore, and they set out in a small fishing boat. Jesus climbed into the boat to take a nap. As soon as his head touched the pillow, he fell asleep. It was a beautiful evening. A gentle breeze rustled the sails. The friends were chatting happily as they headed out into the middle of the lake. Everything was perfect, just right for a nice, quiet sail. They were only about halfway across when out of nowhere, whirling winds swept across the lake, fierce and strong, like a hurricane. A blinding flash of lightning lit up the sky. Thunder roared right overhead. The storm blew the water into towering waves that hurled the little boat up, 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 then sent it hurling, crashing back down, down, down. The fishing boat was blown and buffeted and tossed and turned back and forth and up and down and left and right and round. And in the middle of the storm, Jesus was sleeping. Now, Jesus' friends had been fishermen all their lives, but in all their years fishing on this lake, they had never once seen a storm like this one. No matter how hard they struggled with their ropes and sails, they couldn't control their boat. The storm was too big for them. But the storm wasn't too big for Jesus. Help, they screamed. Wake up, quick, Jesus. Jesus opened his eyes. Rescue us, save us, they shrieked. Don't you care? Of course, Jesus cared. This was the very reason he had come, to rescue them, to save them. Jesus stood up and spoke to the storm. "Hush," he said. "That's all." And the strangest thing happened. The wind and the waves recognized Jesus' voice. They had heard it before, of course. It was the same voice that made them in the very beginning. They listened to Jesus and they did what he said. Immediately, the wind stopped, the water calmed down. It glittered innocently in the moonlight and lapped quietly against the side of the boat as if nothing had happened. The little boat bobbed gently up and down. There was a deep stillness and a great quiet all around. Then Jesus turned to his wind-torn friends. "Why were you scared?" he asked. "Did you forget who I am? Did you believe your fears instead of me?" Jesus' friends were quiet as the wind and the waves, and into their hearts came a different kind of storm. "What kind of man is this?" they asked themselves anxiously. "Even the wind and the waves obey him." They said this because they didn't understand. They didn't realize yet that Jesus was the Son of God. Jesus' friends had been so afraid they had only seen the big waves. They had forgotten that if Jesus was with them, they had nothing to be afraid of, no matter how small their boat or how big the storm. Have y'all heard that story before? A little bit of familiarity there. So as we get into Scripture, if you've got a copy of God's Word with you, we're in Mark chapter 4 today, and we'll be in verse 35. If you don't have a copy, I think it'll be on the screens, but bring a Bible with you. There's familiarity in carrying your copy of Scripture. I'd encourage you to make that part of your life. I think technology kind of makes us a little lazy sometimes. We go, "Oh, I don't need to carry my Bible. It's going to be up on the screens." Well, there was one Sunday, I remember, we didn't have screens. Remember that one? So carry your Bible with you, even if it's like the digital kind that you carry on your phone. Carry it with you. So let's kind of back up. Before this story has happened, just looking in the book of Mark, there are some major events that these disciples had already seen Jesus do. Okay? So the first one in Mark chapter 1, verses 21 through 28, Jesus heals a man with an unclean spirit. There's a guy who's possessed by demons, and Jesus comes in and casts the demons out. Anyone ever seen that happen in person in real life? Pretty wild, pretty uncommon. Would I think probably make you step back and take notice of the one doing that, right? Mark chapter 1, verses 29 through 33, Jesus heals Simon's mother-in-law. This is one of my favorite stories in the Bible. So Simon Peter, Jesus is hanging out with him, the disciples, and they go to Simon Peter's mother-in-law's house, and she's real sick, like deathbed kind of sick. So Jesus goes, "Well, we can't have this." So he heals her, and then what happens next? Anyone remember? She gets up and makes lunch. Isn't that great? So like Jesus healed her because he was hungry maybe. I don't know. I mean, he could make food himself, but he was like, "I don't want to take your job from you, ma'am. Get well and go cook us some food." So praise the Lord. Just keep that in mind. If you're feeling well, it's a good time to make food for somebody. That's in the Bible. Mark 1, 40 through 45, Jesus heals a man with leprosy. If you know anything about gross. Okay, that's all I'm going to say. Leprosy is just an awful disease and made people kind of shun from society. And Jesus goes in and goes right up to a man with leprosy and destroys every convention of society and says, "I'm going to get right up here with you, put my hands on you, and I'm going to heal you." And his disciples watched this happen. Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12, Jesus heals a man who's paralyzed. Remember the old... take up your mat and walk. Get up and get back to life. And his disciples watched him do that. Are you seeing kind of this pattern we're building here? Mark chapter 2, 12 through 17. This one might be the craziest miracle he did. Jesus called a tax collector to follow him. Like worse than an IRS man. And Jesus says to this Matthew character who is going in and kind of betraying his own people, collecting taxes for the Roman Empire and then pocketing some for himself. So kind of the lowest of low. And Jesus says, "I want you to come be one of my closest friends and follow me." And his disciples watched that. Mark 3, 1 through 6, there's a guy with a deformed hand, and Jesus goes, reached out and just heals it. So his disciples have seen these events happening. They've been around him. There's a bunch more where it says, you know, Jesus was kind of in the crowd, and people are coming that were sick, and he's just touching them, looking at them, speaking to them, and they're healed. And his disciples are watching all of this happen. And it's interesting, in the book of Mark, Jesus says, man, we've been around folks all day, and I'm worn out. You ever feel that way? You ever just tired? Here's Jesus, the one who God's word says holds all of creation together. And he's around people all day. He says, man, I need to rest. Someone said once, the most holy thing you could do might be to take a nap. I read a thing the other day online that said, if you're mad at everybody around you, you're hungry. And if you're mad at yourself, you need a nap. So pay attention to what your body's telling you. And if you need rest, take rest. So Jesus tells his disciples, he says, let's get on in the boat and let's cross over this lake. We'll go to the other side. Verse 36 of Mark chapter 4, it says, leaving the crowd, they took Jesus with them in the boat, just as he was. I don't know what that means, just as he was, like he didn't change clothes or something, I guess. And the other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose. The waves were breaking into the boat, so the boat was already filling. Now keep in mind, these guys, these disciples, two things about their past. One, they grew up on the water fishing, most of them did. They probably had encountered storms before, right? They'd probably had times when they looked and went, ooh, this might be the worst one yet. Water crashing into their boat, the waves going over the top of the bow. The second thing is they'd been running around with Jesus for a year or so by now and watching the things that he was doing. Watching him deliver people from unclean spirits and healing their bodies, restoring them. They'd seen all the miracles he'd performed, and they're in this boat with him, and the storm is crashing all around them. And they look, and their fearless leader is taking a nap. Can you imagine what that felt like for them? Can you imagine the confusion that would bring about? Well, wait a minute, Jesus, you said that you care for us and that you love us and you'll take care of us, that you'll provide, you'll meet our needs. And here we are with this huge crisis where our lives seem to be at risk. And you're taking a nap? Really? So as the waves crashed more and more, they, of course, became more and more scared. Verse 38 says, but Jesus was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. So they woke him up. Said, teacher, don't you care that we are perishing? Have you ever had that thought in regard to what God's doing in your life? Don't you care? When I lived in Denver, I was on staff at a church there that was a really strong and healthy, dynamic church. As a church, we had planted 24 other churches all across the world. And our pastor was a great guy who loved Jesus and was committed to God's word and was a great teacher and very kind and just the kind of guy you'd look and go, this should be everyone's pastor. And a week after his 46th birthday, he died in a car accident. And not only was he a great pastor, but he was a good, not even good, he was a great mentor and a friend to me. He kind of adopted me. He called me John's stepson. And just kind of made me part of his family. I remember early on in getting to know him, he got mad at me one night. I stopped by their house to drop something off for his son, and I walked up to the front door, and there's like the glass, you know, side light thing, and I look in, and I see Rick sitting in his recliner, and he puts his paper down, puts it back up, keeps reading. I'm going, what is this guy doing? And he puts his paper down, and he looks over and sees me at the window, and he goes, And I opened the door, and I said, hey, is Brett home? He goes, why are you knocking on the door? I said, well, because that's typically what you do to ask someone to come into their home. He goes, it's your home. Walk in the door. Don't knock. It's annoying. Just walk in the house. Okay. So that was this guy. Well, he died, and that put me for about a year in a place of just going, I don't get it. Now, let me tell you what's a challenge. It's challenging to be a youth pastor where your role is to take students, 7th and 8th and 9th and 10th, 11th and 12th graders, and say, I want you to know and love God. He's worth following. You can trust him. He's always good. He's better than anything the world has to offer. And then to go home and say, God, don't you care? Because it seems like if you cared, Rick wouldn't be dead. It seems like if you cared, you would have protected this man who is serving you and building your kingdom in a really difficult place. Don't you care? Now again, Jesus had just been woken up from a nap. So put yourself in that position. I'm tired. I'm worn out. I've had people asking of me all day. I just want to take a nap. And now we've got some wind and waves crashing around, and these yahoos that I called to follow me are waking me up to ask me if I care about them. Remember, Jesus, fully God, also fully human. So what does Jesus do? He gets up, he says, hey, storm, shh. It's enough. My children know that sound. It's usually their name, and then that's enough. It's enough noise. It's enough distraction. It's enough chaos. Jesus speaks to the wind and the waves, this howling storm that has these grown men in fear for their lives, and he says, hush. And in an instant, all of creation bows to their maker. Isn't that amazing? Jesus says, be still. Everything ceased. Everything was calm. And he looks at these men. He looks at these hardened fishermen who've had their entire lives turned upside down. He says, what's wrong, guys? Have you been with me so long? Have you seen so much and still you don't get it? I heard a preacher one time preaching this passage, and he said these disciples looked at God in a pair of sandals and said, who is this? Who is this guy we're hanging out with that even the wind and the waves obey him? I think probably at that moment, their minds and their hearts started to awaken a little more. You see, Jesus was with them in the middle of that storm, wasn't he? He was right there in the midst of it. The same water that was crashing over the side of the boat and splashing them and soaking them was crashing over him. The same thunder and lightning that shook that little boat shook him. What was the difference? He knew who was in control. So the question we have today is, who do we think is in control? Who do we think is the one that is with us in the storm? I talked to a really good friend this week on the phone, and he said, man, I'm really freaking out about our country. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, it seems like everything is just going to hell in a handbasket. I mean, our political system is a mess, and there's so much nonsense and fighting, and there's no unity, and there's no love, and it seems like our country is heading in a really bad direction. And he said, it keeps me up at night. It fills me with anxiety, and I don't know what to do. I said, well, what can you do? How far does your control reach? Can you reach into the White House and make changes? He said, no. I said, can you even control your own state government? No. What about your little county municipality? No. Okay. So what can you control? Well, I don't know. Yeah, exactly. You can work hard. You can serve God. You can love your family. And beyond that, so stop consuming the lies of the enemy. Stop listening to the nonsense that's put out all around us that wants us to be in fear and wants us to look to some man or some political party for hope. Can I lovingly submit to you? We're all human. We're all messed up. There's not a man or a woman on the planet that can save you. So if you're finding your hope in a political affiliation or in a movement or in a cause or in the opportunity we have as a state to secede, it's misplaced hope. See, these men in the boat, if they had put their hope in the boat, they would have realized what? This boat's not going to last forever. It may not last through this storm. Even if it does, there's going to be another one. At some point, this boat is going to fail me. So Jesus, as we sang, the master of the winds and the sea, says, put your hope in me. Trust in me. Rest in me. Hope in me. Find your joy in me. Because why? How many times has Jesus said, oops? Not a one. How many times has Jesus said, I thought this was going to happen, but I was surprised when this happened? Not once. How many times has Jesus waffled on his decision? Not once. He is 100% flawless and trustworthy. And you know who else is? Nobody. So there's a song that a good friend of mine taught at a youth event one time that I want to teach to you. As I've told you before, I believe that music can have a profound impact on our heart and on our mind. So are you guys ready to learn a song? Yes? Good. Good. Nikki's like, oh, do you know this song, Nikki? Oh, I'm so excited. I found a song Nikki doesn't know. Okay, so the song, the lyrics are really simple because it's kind of a kid's song. So us older folks can pick it up too, right? And it's taken right out of what we have just read in God's Word, and it goes like this. With Jesus in your boat, you can smile through the storm, smile through the storm, smile through the storm. With Jesus in your boat, you can smile through the storm as you're sailing home. A lot of blank faces. I mean, come on, no applause, nothing for that? I'm kidding, don't. So now it's the part where you join in with me, okay? So I feel like there's a lot of comfortable sitting going on. I think we should address that first of all. So go ahead and rise up onto your feet. Hold on to the pew in front if you have to. Hold on to your neighbor if you have to. The words are on the screen. So we're going to sing it again as you pick it up, sing it, and we'll go through it a couple times. I expect by like the third time that the ceiling tiles are shaking because we're just nailing it, right? You guys ready? Bill, you ready? Bill's like, oh, yeah, I'm ready. Here it goes. You ready? With Jesus in your boat, you can smile through the storm. Smile through the storm. Smile through the storm. With Jesus in your boat, you can smile through the storm as you're sailing home. That was pretty good for a first try. Can we do better, you think? Let's do it again. Here, and while you're staying, there's a method to the madness here. What do you think the method to the madness is? If you learn this song and let it permeate your mind and let it permeate your heart, then as you're walking through your week this week and you encounter a storm, you can remember the truth of God's word. That with Jesus in your boat, with him alongside you, you can smile in the storm. Because no matter how big the waves get, no matter how chaotic life is getting, you know that Jesus is with you. You know that he'll never forsake you. You know you can trust him. You got that part? Can you guys say, I can trust Jesus? Can you say it like with some a little conviction? It's a little better. Some of you guys, I didn't see your mouths moving. I'm not going to point anybody out. But whether you believe it or not doesn't change who Jesus is. You can trust him. So you guys ready one more time? With Jesus in your boat, you can smile through the storm. Smile through the storm, smile through the storm. With Jesus in your boat, you can smile through the storm as you're sailing home. That was great. You guys can applaud yourselves now. That was very nice. Have a seat. Man, a very simple truth, right? So easy that a kid can sing that song. And if I wanted to be obnoxious, I'd teach you the real way it goes where you drop a word and it goes on forever. We're not going to do that. Here's the thing. Jesus said, if you want to come to God, how do you come? Like a child, with childlike faith. Because you know what a child does? They just hear the truth and they go, okay. And as we get older, we start to get this mentality of, well, yeah, but really? And we start to question and go, well, that may be true for you, but I've got to look at it through the filter of my own life. And a child says, well, if you said that I can trust Jesus in the middle of a storm, then I can trust Jesus in the middle of a storm. Guess what? When you're 75 years old, you can trust Jesus in the middle of a storm. When you're 95 years old, you can trust Jesus. I wasn't looking anywhere in particular. When you're 15, you can trust Jesus. When you're sending your kid off to college, you can trust Jesus. When your retirement fund looks like it's not big enough, you can trust Jesus. When the doctor gives bad news, what? Yeah. When you get a bonus check, you can trust Jesus. See, here's the beauty of Jesus. He's not just Jesus for the bad times. He's Jesus all the time. That boat trip started out beautiful, serene. And then it was bad, and then what? It was beautiful and serene again, wasn't it? So no matter where you are today, you can trust Jesus. No matter where you are tomorrow, you can. At 2 o'clock in the morning when your mind's racing, you keep looking at the alarm clock going, running out hours to sleep, freaking out about whatever, you can trust Jesus. Now here's the thing, that sounds like churchy. Yeah, it's Sunday morning, we're sitting in the pews. Yeah, we can trust Jesus. So what does that look like at 2 in the morning when I'm laying in bed staring at the ceiling? For me, here's what it looks like. Jesus, I need rest. I'm tired. And this is the time that I'm supposed to be resting, and my mind is racing, and my heart is beating fast, and I'm freaking out here. So Jesus, will you just be peace in my life right now? You promised that you are the Prince of Peace, so will you just show me that part of yourself right now and just be peace, quiet my mind and quiet my heart? That's a real conversation that I have with the Lord consistently. Jesus, you say you're this, prove it. Be that, because that's what I need right now. You know what the amazing thing about Jesus is? When you ask him to show himself to you, you know what he does? He shows himself to you. Because his goal isn't, it's not hide and seek with him. It's seek and find with him. It's reaching out and saying, Jesus, I need you. I need you to just hold my hand right now. Because I might stumble. I'm unsure of my footing. It's dark where I am right now. So will you just hold me? You can trust Jesus. And with Jesus in your boat, you can smile through the storm all the way home. Do you believe that today? Father, I thank you for the beauty of your word, and I thank you for folks like Sally Lloyd-Jones who have taken the gospel and written an amazing book that shows how you're woven all the way through it, how hope and redemption and forgiveness and salvation are on every page of your word. And I don't know today what storms are in folks' lives. I know what are in mine. And I don't know what's coming this week, but you do. So I pray for myself and my family and my friends here today that your Holy Spirit would unite with your word and burrow this truth deep into our hearts and into our minds, and that it would not just be another tidbit of information that we carry along with us, but God, that it would be life-changing truth. That it would be perspective-shifting reality for us. Because you promise to be near to the brokenhearted. You promise that your arm is not too short to save us. You promise that you walk with us, as King David said, that even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we don't have to fear anything. So, Father, this week, as the waves crash and the thunder rolls and the lightning strikes, I pray that you would remind us of the time after time after time after time that you have been enough for us. God, remind us of when you have healed, when you have restored, when you have forgiven, when you have raised up. Remind us when you brought us from death into life, and then use those memories to gin up faith in us to trust you. Remind us that you do care. Remind us that you're in the boat with us in the middle of the storm. And that there is nothing beyond your control. We thank you, Lord. Amen.